here, people, and listen. Well, I'm with the legendary Bill Wang, and this is the Syncin Wang Show. Hey, Wang, how's it going this week?
Oh, man, it's going pretty good, my brother. man, everything's great. Nothing really crazy to report. Things are going good here. I'm in a very dangerous territory right now. I know people think I'm bullshitting, but fuck them. This is very dangerous Vinny Vincent invasion gang territory. This is a very dangerous.
Man.
Yeah, man, it is. But, you know, hey, it's all fucking, you know, it's all Hollywood, right? So I got to be on the show and I got to represent and I got to watch out for these motherfuckers. But, man, hey. So what's the fuck? What's been going on with you? Did I hear this right? You made Blabbermouth like again?
Oh yeah, Lieutenant Shane from the Sink Army got another great Blabbermouth article from James LaBrie, the singer of Dream Theater. It was awesome, man. It was awesome. Everybody needs to check that out, man. We're on Blabbermouth again, Sink Army.
Right, that's so cool. Right on, right on.
Hey, man. I heard you got some news going on out there. You got some big festival out there in California, not too far from you. So you want to talk about that a little bit?
Oh, hell yeah, dude. I've been fascinated by this festival since when they first reported it. It's not necessarily close to me. It's in the same state, but I just did a GPS, and it's 508 miles from where I am right now.
Wow.
It would take 7.5 hours to drive there. But yeah, man, I was real curious. Friday night I checked out Iron Maiden and I checked out Guns N' Roses. Iron Maiden was fucking brilliant, amazing. Guns N' Roses, just with all due respect. I love three albums of Guns N' Roses, but I'm kinda like past that whole shit. It's like, all right, next. But damn,
Axel sounds like Herbert the pervert now.
Well, you know what? It sucks. You know, I'm a big fan. Saw Guns N' Roses 4 times in 1988 alone. You know, it sucks. Everybody gets old. So I'm not going to thank them for that. But anyway, but Iron Maiden was brilliant. Brilliant.
I saw some of the footage, man. They found awesome, man. I saw the prisoner caught somewhere in time.
Yeah.
It's just amazing how he can move around on stage and still sing like that.
Oh, I know. It's fucking phenomenal, dude. Phenomenal. Amazing. So I'm checking that. And then I checked out AC/DC from last night. And Brian Johnson is like a year younger than my mom. So, man, I give AC/DC all the fucking credit. Was it AC/DC on the Who Made Who tour in 1986? Well, fuck, of course it's not. You know, but it was pretty goddamn good for really old people, dude. And, I'm just glad they're back. And tonight's going to be phenomenal. You've got Tool and Metallica. I'm one of the biggest Tool fans in the world.
Oh, yeah, that's right. We got them coming up.
Yeah. So I'm really excited to see that. Metallica's still phenomenal. Are they what they were on the Ride the Lightning tour? Well, how could they be? They were in their early 20s. Now they're like late 50s, early 60s. So here's the deal, man. Tonight's going to be cool. Tonight's going to be cool with Tool. Anyways, yeah, so I saw the crowd's been like over 80,000. So I always fuck as you do. We all root on our hard rock, heavy metal icon heroes. And I'm just really very cool. And I have a positive thing about the whole thing. And there you go. I can keep waxing poetic, dude. So what do you think, dude?
You forgot about the Mighty Priest. Judas Priest played.
Oh, that's right. The sublet. Yeah. My bad. I saw them. They're pretty goddamn good.
Well, they're great.
Are they Defenders of the Faith tour? No. But very cool.
And it was cool. They had Glenn come out for a few songs at the end. So that was awesome.
I saw that. That was very fucking cool, dude. Fuck yeah.
I didn't think we'd see that again, but they brought him out. So that was awesome.
Right, exactly.
Yeah.
Right. Hey, before I forget, I read a comment on, I don't know, a few episodes ago, and I apologize, I don't remember the guy's name, but he made reference to a straw in my beer. I took your advice, brother. Bam!
Yeah, all right. You got to listen to the fans, man.
Exactly, man. Exactly. You know what I'm saying? Dilly D. Bop, 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 bop. Bam.
When they got good advice, follow it.
Exactly.
So, Wang, this is a good segue, man, about what we're going to talk about this week. So you want to tell everybody what we're going to talk about?
Yeah, man. What we're going to talk about is another simple little, you know, ranking shit. But, you know, we all know ranking shit does good. We're going to talk about our top 10 greatest concerts ever.
Hell yeah.
And for the most part, we've been pretty exclusive to hard rock, heavy metal. And even though everything I'm going to talk about is rock, but maybe not necessarily hard rock metal. But anyways, there's two bands, or maybe three, whatever. But yeah, man, our top 10 concerts of our life.
Awesome. Awesome. Well, man, you want me to kick it off?
Kick it off, Syncin Stanley.
Let's get into this, man.
Yeah, let's get it.
My number 10 band that I saw live, man, oh, they blew me away. And it was with the original singer and original guitar player, and that's Foreigner. Foreigner, that's right, man. Oh, my God, did they kick ass, man. Oh, seeing Lou Gramm.
What year, bro?
Oh, it had to be like 1990, 91-ish. Right around that time.
Right on, man. Right on.
Cool. Oh, they sounded so good, man. They were just so good. It just blew me away. And it was only at a county fair, but I was right up to the stage, man. I was right there under Lou.
Right.
They sounded phenomenal, man. They did all their hits, man. They did Yesterday. Oh, man, that was awesome. Love that song. Yep. Cool. Yeah, man. So what's your number 10, Wang?
My number 10, you know, here's the deal. I don't know what the fuck it is about number 10 being tied with shit. The last thing was, I had, Sabotage and Pantera, blah, 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 tie. So I have another tie.
Uh-oh.
And here it is. David Bowie, May 28th, 1990, the Sound and Vision Tour, which was fucking amazing.
Wow.
That is tied with Nirvana at the Oakland Arena on December 31st, 1993. And for a little bit, it was tied, but then I started digging shit out and how Bowie crushes Nirvana because Nirvana has like three albums. David Bowie, Sound and Vision Tour. Fuck yeah. With Lori Sue, God rest your soul, sweetie. I love you forever. She passed away back in 2008. It sucks. So it means a lot to me, man. Yay.
That's awesome, man. Do you remember who was playing guitar for him on that tour?
Gabriel Reeves.
Okay, cool. Yeah, that's awesome, man.
Fuck yeah.
Wow. Anything else you got to say about that tour that stood out to you?
No, not really, man. It means a lot to me. And it was really emotional even thinking back about it.
Yeah.
Because it was my woman that I'm not going to get into it, but a very important person. And so she passed away on June
18th, 2008. Sorry to hear that, man.
I was with her off and on for 19 years. I was a little kid, early 20s, and she was in her 30s. She was like the original. Anyways, great memories. David Bowie. I love David Bowie. I've loved David Bowie, and I got into David Bowie almost the same weekend I got into the Sex Pistols back in 78. So there you go, man. Syncin Stanley, David Bowie number 10.
Hey, man. I love me some Bowie too, man.
Fuck yeah.
All right, let's go to number 9. And my number 9, get ready to laugh. Everybody's going to laugh at this shit, but I don't give a fuck. Because it was Steelheart. Oh, my God. That guy, man. I was like, holy crap. Is this guy going to do it live? Is he going to hit that note live? And I'm watching him, man. And damn, did he hit it, man. Out of the box, man. Holy cow. God.
Wow.
Steelheart, man. Man, the guy just blew me away, man. And then, you know, he went on to do other stuff. Like he was the singer in the background of that movie Rockstar. So there you have it, man.
Oh, wow. Yeah, I couldn't name one song. I think I think I heard of that band, but I don't know anything about him. So right on, man.
They did that song Never Let You Go. That real high scream, man.
I probably tried to forget it, dude. I don't know.
yeah, a lot of people do. But I don't care, man.
It's all good, brother, man. Stand strong. Be proud. Bam!
The guy blew me away. All right, what's your number nine, Wang?
Number nine is August 15th, 1986. The Cow Palace in San Francisco, California. The first time I saw the mighty AC/DC on the Who Made Who tour. I brought this up a billion times. And then the opening band was this band called Queensryche, and they were promoting the Rage for Order tour.
Yes.
Amazing, amazing, amazing. That's my number nine, brother, man.
Wow, man. That's a great one, man. Yeah. I love the song Who Made Who, by the way, too. Just the song, man. And the video, and the video with all the Anguses.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, man. That's great stuff. All right. Well, let's get to our number eight. And my number eight is Cheap Trick. Man, I saw them back right after they put out Woke Up to a Monster. It was like in between Woke Up to a Monster and their 97 self-titled album. It was somewhere in there. They were touring. They were having to make money, you know. And it was so awesome because it's the only time I've gotten to see Cheap Trick. And I managed to meet all four of the members, man, all four original members. They all signed my Budokan CD. I got to meet Todd Howarth from Frehley's Comet, was playing keyboards for him. It was awesome, man. I got to ask Rick Nielsen, how was it to work with Gene Simmons on his solo album?
Cool.
And Rick Nielsen, he got all animated and shit. He's like, oh, and I got to see him without her makeup. Oh, man, it was cool, man. It was just cool, man. It was cool meeting them, and the show was great. They sounded phenomenal. Robin Zander, one of the most underrated vocalists of all time. Oh, my God. Yeah, Cheap Trick, my number eight. All right, Wang, what's your number eight, buddy?
My number eight should have never happened, and here's why. Back in 1988, Dio on the Dream Evil tour hooked up with Megadeth on the So Far So Good tour, and then way down on the bottom of the list was Savatars on the Hall of the Mountain King tour. So they crisscrossed the country, dilly d, ba 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 bam, and then for some weird reason, about a week before, or maybe, I don't know, maybe a couple weeks, they jumped off the tour, and then they were on their own. So on March 8th of 1988 at the Stone, the famous Stone in San Francisco, I saw Savatage on the Hall of Mountain King tour, and the place probably held, it doesn't exist anymore, I'd say, fuck, man, I'd say like 800 people. So wow. Savatage, Hall of the Mountain King tour, and an itty-bitty little fucking club. Amazing. Number, yeah, amazing. Bam!
Number eight. All right, Savatage. Man, that must have been awesome, man. I love me some Savatage, man. Yeah, that Hall of the Mountain King. Whoo! Wow.
Yeah. Absolutely, brother, man. Fucking sick as fuck.
Awesome, man.
Boy up there, all fat as fuck. You know, I love Paul. He's my boy, Chris Olivia, and anyway,
John Olivia.
John, yeah, John. Chris is dead. Yeah. So, anyways, opening up with Sirens, the whole fucking shit was badass. Yeah. So, all right,
there
you go.
That's awesome, man. That's awesome. Well, My number seven, keeping it progressive, man. This is kind of like a double concert because I got to see this band do a meet and greet with them. And then I got to see them again 2 days later, right up the road. They did a headline show. And that band is Fate's Warning. I saw them with Queensryche, the Todd LaTorre version. But I got
Scab Queensryche.
Yes, Scab Queensryche. But no, I got to see Fate's Warning twice in one weekend. And it was amazing, man. I got to meet them, hang out with them. I got to sing a little bit of Whispers on the Wind with Ray Adler, the singer. It was like a dream come true, bro. That's one of my favorite bands of all time.
I know it is, dude. You know it is.
Oh, man, it was just incredible, man. I got so many pictures, and it was great, man. Just that was a great weekend, man. Seeing them back-to-back. Yeah.
Awesome. So cool. Like I told you before, I don't know shit about that band except they're kind of a, you know, Queensryche Jr.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, no, that's fine.
It don't matter what I think, what Billy, Jimmy, Simi, da ba 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 ba. It's all about you, brother man. Fate's Warning is your pick.
Hell yeah. Well, all right, Bill, what's your number seven?
Pantera, November 15th, 1997, at the San Jose Civic Center, with John Bush's version of Anthrax opening up. It was fucking magical. Amazing. Whoa. Yeah. I was thinking, before I'm all thinking, well, that must have been the Great Southern Trendkill tour, looking back a quarter century later. But then I was doing my research, and apparently that was a live record that came out documenting that tour, 101 Live or something like that. But
Okay, cool.
Yeah. So Pantera with Anthrax. I'm going to be honest with you. Joey Belladonna's Anthrax is great, but there was something special about that John Bush shit. It was different. It wasn't like, you know, it wasn't the same shit repeated over and over and over again. So I give massive props to the John Bush era Anthrax. And this night in particular, it was S-I-C-K Bammer.
Oh, yeah. There's nothing wrong with John Bush and Anthrax. He was a great singer, man. And they did some great tunes with him, man. I love that stuff.
Oh, really? Okay, cool.
Oh, yeah. I love the John Bush era of Anthrax, but I'm always gonna go back to the Joey era because that's what I grew up with. But you know,
yeah, I never spoken about that with you, so this is the first time ever. So, right on. Me too. I love that
shit. Cool. Oh yeah, I've seen John Bush Anthrax a couple times.
Yes, so have I. Uh huh.
Yeah. All right, we're at number six. And my number six is the Mighty Metallica and Justice for All tour. And I got to see them with Queensryche opening up for the Mindcrime tour. And let me tell you, man, that was out of control. I was right up front for Queensryche because, you know, I was a major Queensryche fan, especially around that time. And I was like, man, I'm getting right up front for Queensryche. I got right up front. Man, I felt so bad because the Metallica fans were taking the Queensryche guitar picks and throwing them back and hit Chris DeGarmo right in the face with one of their picks. I was like, you motherfuckers, I want one of those.
You motherfuckers, you keep it up. Chris is going to leave the band in 5 years. Oh, that's all.
Oh, shit. Yeah, right?
And that was Queensryche, by the way. Chris leave, Queensryche dead.
Pretty much, man. Pretty much.
Just my opinion, brother. Just my opinion.
Hey, man, that's a lot of people's opinion, and I'd be one to greatly agree with you.
All right, brother. Right on, dude. Right on.
But no, Metallica were awesome, man, and Justice for All. I mean, as soon as Metallica came out, I ain't going to lie, man. I had to get back, man. I was getting crushed. I mean, the pits started right away, man. I was just like, man, I'm getting out of here before I get killed.
And here's a caveat. Syncin Stanley, here's the deal with the pits at Injustice Tour. I was there at the Monsters of Rock, and then all the I saw like a lot of Injustice Tours. But here's the difference. They're a bunch of kids in their early 20s and teenagers. Now they're a bunch of old people in their 40s and 50s.
True.
Yeah, younger people too. But you know what I'm saying.
Oh, I know what you're saying. But still, man, it was wild, man. It was a great show. Love it.
Hell yeah.
Daytona Beach Ocean Center. All right, Bill, what's your number six, man?
You mean seven.
We're at number six.
Okay, I got a little thing. All right, number six. One, two, three. Iron Maiden, Guns N' Roses. June 5th, 1988. I brought this up the last episode. My little list is, it's all fucked up. But yeah, Iron Maiden, Seventh Son Tour, the prog metal masterpiece,
awesome.
And Guns N' Roses. It was so sick. I was, I would say 15 rows, section 102, 15 rows back. I recorded Guns N' Roses and Iron Maiden. I still had the Guns N' Roses recording, but I got my Iron Maiden was taken away from me. And yeah, man, that is, I don't see how that's number six, but whatever. Here we go, man.
Yeah. Oh yeah. That tour, I almost had a chance to see that tour with Ace Frehley opening.
Yeah. So. Right. Sick. The faggot ass band, album Second Coming. One, two, three.
Oh wait, man, we fucked up, bro. I told you.
I got my shit, dude. and unfortunately, I had to retape. But yeah, the fact of the matter is, Pantera Anthrax was my number. I fucked up. Oh well. But anyways, continue on, Mr. Syncin Stanley. I'm trying to figure out this shit because obviously I'm a little fucked up. You're a little fucked up, and we're all a little fucked up. And we're in San Francisco. We got all these fucking Vinnie Vincent gang members. Fuck you, bitch. He's ready to attack me with a little pink fucking knife. But brother man, yeah. So
Pantera was your number seven. Iron Maiden, Seventh Son of a Seventh Son, was your number six.
Right, but well, no. Hold on. Actually. Pantera, I'm going to read it exactly. It goes Bowie number 10, AC/DC Queens Rock 86 number 9, Sabotage number 8 and 88. Then I wrote Pantera Anthrax 97 number 7. And then I went, Iron Maiden Guns N' Roses June 5th, 88 number 8. So I go 8787.
No, oh, that's your number 6, man. You just numbered it wrong.
No, I'm talking about what I actually wrote down,
I know. Yeah,
so it's a clusterfuck, but it's all good heart.
It's all good because you know why? We're halfway there. We're at number five. And number five is Judas Priest Painkiller Tour. I saw that shit in Lakeland with Testament open, but unfortunately I went with a buddy and we missed Testament, but I got to see the tail end of the Rust in Peace tour with Megadeth opening up. And yeah. Man, oh God, that was so awesome, man. Priests were so on fire. That was right before Rob Halford left to do Fight. It was the last tour with Rob.
Yeah.
Man, it was incredible, dude. I was so glad I got to see the original Priest lineup. You know, their drummer's always changed.
Right.
But, you know, Scott Travis was on.
Steve Harden was the longest, Syncin Stanley.
What's that?
Dave Holland was there the longest, 1980 Ramadown 88.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, but, man, Scott Travis was bad as hell on drums. Painkiller. Oh. All right, Wang, what's your number five?
Well, first of all, I got to say, number five on my list is David Lee Roth, Eat Him and Smile Tour, December 12th, 1986. But I somehow fucked up. I got number, I got my, you know, Priest, July 27th, 1984, Defenders of the Faith with Chubby. And then I had one before that, Metallica, December 31st, 1985, going into 86 with Megadeth, Exodus and Metal Church. So I fucked up and that's on me. But I cannot, I can't not ignore what my list says. So anyway, so yeah, it's a clusterfuck and it's a car crash, but that's basically what we're all about. A car crash.
So David Lee Roth, Eat 'Em and Smile Tour, that's your number five.
Yeah. December 12th, 1986. First time I ever saw David Lee Roth. Unfortunately, my mom was very strict, you know, preventing me to go to concerts until I was 30 years old.
Oh, man, I know. I hear you.
Yeah. But, yeah, that was so sick.
I wanted to see that tour.
What's that?
I wanted to see that tour so bad. I was so pissed when all the kids came to school with their shirts on. And I wasn't able to go see it.
It was amazing. It was the best time I ever saw that guy live. I'm sure if I saw all the Van Halen tours before that, it would have been great. But fuck yeah. Eat 'Em and Smile Tour, December 12th, 1986. Bam.
Yeah. All right. Number four. Well, my number four. Your number five was just David Lee Roth.
Right.
So we're at number four.
Okay.
Number four for me is Kiss, Hot in the Shade. Oh, my God. My first time seeing Kiss. And what a show to see, because, man, I tell you what, that was one hell of a set list. Oh, my God. Opening up with I Stole Your Love. Oh, man, they did so many songs that night. It was amazing. Amazing.
I agree. I was there, dog. I was there. Awesome.
But unfortunately, I hate to do it, but, you know, I'm the head of the Sync Army. And when you hear something, you gotta let the world know. Apparently, Kiss were faking it even back then.
Yeah, you told me that. You told me that, like, last week.
I have a very reliable source. I cannot mention names, but I was told that Paul Stanley's guitar playing was faked through a keyboard.
Wow.
So hopefully one day that story will come out. If it hasn't already come out, it might have been on Decibel Geek, to be honest with you. But I don't think they even talked about that part of it. But, okay. Yeah.
So, yeah, I know that podcast. The main guy, Chris and Zach.
Oh, yeah. Chris and Aaron Camaro. Yep. They got a great podcast, Decibel Geek. And they have a two-part episode with Gary Corbett, the keyboard player.
Oh, is that right? Cool.
Oh, yeah. It's awesome. Y'all, Kiss, all you Kiss tards out there, I highly recommend you looking up those episodes, because there's a lot of minutiae on the Kiss tours from Gary Corbett on there.
Yeah. My connection to Chris Sinzak, it goes before Facebook, before rocking, you know, any podcast, aside from Talking Metal. That's where I met Chris Sinzak, is our mutual connection to Mark Striegel and John Astronomy. Because, that's where I met that. I mean, not meet him. I've never met him in real life, but that's where I became aware of him. And I've always respected the guy, and he's always been fair with me and very, very, Christian Zach rules. That's all
yes,
I got to say.
Yes, he does. Yes, he does.
Absolutely.
All right, Wang, what's your number four?
My number four was May 25th, 1984, at the Cow Palace in my little city called San Francisco, but a ways from where I am. It's out in, admittedly, a very bad area. My complexion does not make the connection, if you know where I'm going. Anyways. Rush and Gary Moore, May 25th, 1984, Grace Under Pressure Tour. The first time I ever saw my fucking band, my motherfucking, I love them. And it was amazing. And here's the deal with that. They sold out four nights at the Cow Palace. They have, hear me, Burt McGovern, They have never played four nights, consecutive nights in the Bay Area. But that's the one time they did. And I was lucky enough to see him. And I was lucky enough to see Gary Moore when he was in his hard rock phase. Not that blues bullshit, when he was fucking rocking it out. I got quarters of power. I don't know exactly. Maybe that was it. Maybe I'm wrong. But number four is Rush at the Cow Palace.
Hell yeah. That's the one band I wish I would have seen, man. I never got to see him.
Yeah, I saw him 23 times, got every single ticket stub to prove it.
Well, I'm sure you did, man, being a kind of Rush fan you are. Hell yeah. Hell yeah.
Yeah, Syncin Stanley!
Rush! Rush rule!
Hey, rule, rule, rule!
All right, it's down to the top three, and my number three is Ozzy, the Ultimate Sin Tour with Queensryche, Rage for Order. Oh, wow. My God. Oh, my God. Oh, my God. It was so awesome. And I ain't going to lie. I didn't go for Ozzy. I went for Queensryche. And, right. Oh, man, that's my very first concert. And, man, it just blew me away. I was right up on stage. Chris DeGarmo comes walking out with that long coat on with their permed hairstyles. Walks up to his acoustic guitar and starts right. playing New Regal. Oh, right. My God.
I love that scene, dude.
Oh, my God. Bill, it was just incredible, man. And then Ozzy came out with Jake. Oh, man, what a memory for a first concert, man. Ozzy coming down in that big old goblin bat.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, and he's all sequined out, looking all glam metal bullshit.
Oh, yeah. But it was still cool, man.
Bad fucking ass.
It was badass, man. I don't care, man. I love it. And I love The Ultimate Sin. That's a great album, man.
I love it, too.
I love it, man. I love it to death.
Yep.
All right, Wang, what's your number three?
Number three would be a band, and in particular, this concert in particular was I went to with, if I'm being honest, the love of my life. I mean, Michelle's up there also, but Lori Sue, number one, God rest her soul. She passed away, a day before the Celtics won the 2008 championship, and it was The Cure, and it was, their basically masterpiece Disintegration. Oh, and, they played, Shoreline in Oakland, arena. And then the weekend after, they sold that Dodger Stadium. They were on pop. And, you know, people, oh, they're pop. Now, here's the deal with The Cure. Yes, they have pop songs, but there's a very big prog element to The Cure. In particular, Disintegration and Wish. Disintegration 89, Wish 92. They have a lot of prog influence to them. So that was that third greatest concert I've ever been to. And that is a fact.
Oh, man, disclaimer here. Syncin Stanley loves The Cure. The Cure are awesome. Disintegration, that's borderline metal, man. Hell yeah.
It's borderline at least prog, yeah.
Fascination Street, my favorite band, Fate's Warning, the lead singer Ray Adler, with Joey Vera from Armored Saint, they had a little band called Engine, and they did a cover of Fascination Street.
It was
metal as fuck, and it was awesome, man. I love it. I love me some Cure, man. I ain't gonna lie, man. I'm just a casual fan, but I love all their hits, man. Just like Heaven, Love Song, Fascination Street. What's that one song? Hot, Hot, Hot. I love that stuff, man. Love it. Yeah, nothing wrong with The Cure, man. Nothing at all. Well, all right, Wang. We're down to our top two.
Yep, we are down to our top two. Give me your number two, Syncin Stanley.
Well, my number two is the almighty Kiss reunion tour. Oh, my God. I never thought I'd see it, and then it happened. They all got back together, all original members, slapped on that war paint, put on their platform shoes, and it was... Bam! Kiss 1977 again. I was like, oh, I went and saw that. Oh, man. Dude, I had tears in my eyes. I was screaming. It was such a beautiful thing, man, to see that original lineup up there. During Deuce doing the swaying back and forth. Peter singing Beth. Oh, man. Dude, ain't nothing like that, man.
Yep.
Oh, yeah. The reunion tour, man. That's my number two.
Yeah.
Yep. I'm sure you caught the reunion tour, didn't you?
Oh, yeah, I did, but I feel guilty not putting it up there, but for emotional purposes, maybe I should have put it up there, but compared to the Creatures of the Night tour, no way, Jose, man. anyways, man, I don't want to get into it too much, but it would be – the reunion tour would probably be number 12, but I love it, but I'm just going to be – I'm just going to be real. No bullshit. No diddly dee. No bah, 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 bam or any bullshit. But awesome. I saw that tour August. Don't quote me. I think August 25th, 1996 at the Shoreline Amphitheater with my ex friend, Gary Betancourt. It was amazing. But yeah, there you go. Great pick, Syncin Stanley.
Awesome. So Wang, what's your number two?
Well, my number two and my number one have been one or two since the day I saw them. Okay. Wow. Yeah. And people are going to be surprised I'm picking this at number two. But I had to really I just had to look in the mirror and what concert was more important and more influential. And number one is more than Kiss. So Kiss Creatures of the Night Tour, Easter Sunday, 1983. About, I would say, five blocks south of where I am right now. Wow. I'm in Polk Street in Van Ness on east-west. And then south-north, it would be Sutter and Post. So just to give you an idea where I'm at. And, Creatures of the Night Tour, it was amazing.
I would have loved to seen that.
And then to see Motley Crue in 1983.
Oh, God. Motley Crue opened up for him.
Yeah, and it was 4 months before Shout at the Devil came out. And
wow.
And the cool thing about it is they opened up the show, you know, in the beginning before Shout at the Devil. Yeah, it was so fucking demonic and sick and badass. And, yeah, man.
That's great.
This is the Night Tour number two.
So you saw Vinny in full makeup.
You're damn straight I did.
See, that's why it's so special for you. Was that the first time you saw Kiss in makeup?
Yeah, it was the first time I saw Kiss ever. You know,
there because, you go. That's why.
Yeah, it was amazing. Sick. And the thing about it, you know, you read that one guy's book, Kurt Gooch. All the dates and everything, how their sales sucked here, there, and everything. That night, back in Easter 1983, the place was packed. And back then, the place was called the San Francisco Civic Center. Now it's called the Bill Graham Civic Center. And it was so – I was thinking about doing this video in front of it, but I ran into all sorts of bullshit, so I decided not to do that. But, yeah, man.
You know why it was so packed? Because what? San Francisco has the highest level of Vinnie Vincent Invasion gang members. And they were probably all there in full support.
You know, I really appreciate the fact that you're acknowledging the Vinnie Vincent Invasion gang. The Vinnie Vincent Invasion Gang. You're goddamn right they were there. They were there in full effect. They had their little business cards, Vinnie Vincent Invasion Gang members. So, yeah, it was so sick. And I have nothing but amazing memories. And, there you go, man.
Awesome, man. Awesome. Well, all right. Down to number one. My number one. Man himself, the man that made me pick up the guitar, Ace Frehley. That's my number one concert. Why is that my number one concert? Because not only did I get to see Ace Frehley solo, and I got to see him 1993, the Just for Fun tour, I got to do everything. I got to play bass in his sound check. I got to meet his band, help his band out all day. And then later on in the day, I got to go on the tour bus and meet Ace and hang out with his band right up until showtime. And what was Ace doing when I got to meet him?
Lines of cocaine.
No, he was in the back of his bus putting his smoking Les Paul together. I shit you not. Dude, I was speechless. I couldn't say another word the rest of the night. I was just like, oh my God. I'm on the bus with Ace Frehley. He's putting his smoking Les Paul together.
Sick ass shit, dude. Sick ass shit.
We're listening to Hendrix and the Jerky Boys up until showtime. It was awesome, man.
I got paintwork, Jerky Boys. I got paintwork.
You can't beat that, man. That tops it all, man, for me. Number one, Ace Frehley. Ace Frehley, number one. What's your number one, Wang?
Well, before I get to number one, I believe I saw that same tour, and I told you this on the phone the other night. It was at the Stone, the famous Stone. And I hear me, man. This is a fact. Ace Frehley, I'm not trying to hate. I'm not trying to be a jerk. But Ace was literally in back of the amps lining himself up with rock, huge lines of coke. I literally watched Ace Frehley do a line of coke. That's wow. A fact. That's a fact. That's not hyperbole. Not top diddly dee. But anyway, I mean, I was spun too. Me and my ex-friend Gary Bencor was all spun on that, but... Yeah, great pick, Syncin Stanley. Awesome.
All right. All right. All right, Wang. What's your number one, man?
My number one concert, if I'm being honest, and I am, I had to reevaluate. Just like I put Van Halen with Roth above Judas Priest, I'm going to say the number one concert ever was October 23rd. 1982, my first live concert ever. And I was on Mick Jones's, the last thing I mentioned a concert, and I talked about the Clash, and I said, Homeboy is a guitar player. Well, Homeboy is Mick Jones, okay? And the Clash is a really huge band for me, man. Very influential.
Cool.
So anyways, it would be Dan the Green, The Who, number one, The Clash opening. It was my first concert, and if I'm saying anything other, I'd be dishonest. It was the most influential concert ever. I thought as a teenager that The Who was like old as fuck because they were in their late 30s, you know, like my parents and blah, blah, blah. John Entwistle, Roger Daltrey and Pete Townsend are all older than my mom. Daltrey is the same age as my father, but I just said, you know, and now looking back at 37 and 38, we thought that was old. But it was the most powerful concert I ever saw. 70 fucking thousand people. I was way the fuck down there on the right side stage, Mick Jones, The Clash, the great, the epic Pete Townsend on guitar on the right-hand side of the stage. I was on the elevated seats. So you got the floor, and then the first elevated seats, I was like in the middle. I was like 75 feet pure view of the stage. It was the most powerful shit ever. John Entwistle is the most underrated bass player in the history of the fucking world.
Hell yeah.
Yeah. Number one, The Who, 1982.
All right. Awesome, man. That's awesome. Well, there you have it, everybody. Our top 10 concert experiences. You can't beat those, man. Those are some pretty good concerts, man.
Yeah. Yes, they are.
Hell yeah. All right. All right, Bill, you got anything else you want to wrap this up with?
No, man, but other than we're going to take next week off. Syncin Stanley.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, Syncin Stanley's going to this situation. So we're going to take a week off, so we'll see you in 2 weeks. So hopefully you like our episode. And we're really overwhelmed by the response to our show. And we're only going to try to do better. We understand we're not the Adam Carolla show. Baby steps. But we're going to be in it for the long run. So don't give up on the Syncin Wang show.
Hell no. All right. Well, this is the Syncin Wang show. And we'll see you again real soon. Hell yeah.
This has been a Think Army production.
Bam!
Famcast Media.